Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Let's do this. You didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. It's about us coming together and hearing from God. So if you have the ability, stand to your feet, and I'm going to get down on my knees, and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Thank you, Carrie. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful we get to come into your house. And truly, Jesus, we stand amazed in your presence, in awe of who you are. And so, God, today, as we open up your word, we pray that you open it up to us. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear. May we have a good heart of understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Holy Spirit, welcome in this place. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, even the direction, the correction we need. Lord, we give you the praise and the glory for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we would ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building one kingdom that's yours. So God, we'd ask that you bless the Baptists, the Lutherans, the Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Lord, we thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, for Oak Valley, for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist. Too many churches to name by name, but God, if they're preaching your gospel, bless them. Bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, the Foursquare denomination, and the Assemblies of God and Victory Outreach, God. All the great churches, Lord, we bless them as you bless us. And Father, we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world to strengthen them, encourage them, protect them, and bless them, God. Lord, in our nation, elections are coming, and we do pray for our leaders, as you say in your word. God, we lift them up to you. We pray that you give us leaders after your own heart who will make wise and godly decisions. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say,
amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, if you will. As you're turning there, the title of today's message is The Illuminated Life. The Illuminated Life. We're going to find out what that means as we go to Hebrews, the 10th chapter. We're in verse number 32 through verse number 34. Once again, last time we were together, you remember we talked about forgetfulness, the human condition. Brilliant message by Pastor Luke. If you didn't get a hold of that, I would encourage you to download it online or go and get the CD out there at the CD counter. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse 32. We continue our study and our understanding from the Word of God. And it says these words, "But recall the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great struggle with sufferings." Verse 33, "Partly while you were made a spectacle both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated." Verse 34, "For you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and enduring possession for yourselves in heaven." Now back in verse number 32, look at what it says. "Recall the former days in which after you were illuminated." Now, we're called by God to live an illuminated life. And when you have light, it changes the perspective. It changes the way that you see things. I'm going to give an example of this. So those of you that are standing around, get ready because I'm going to do something. So make sure to grab your seat real quick. But I want to show you this visually, okay? If I had them turn the lights down, let's go ahead and turn the lights down in the place, okay? Now, they're turning the house lights down. Oh, and now I can tell who's using their phone and their tablet to read the word today. You guys look like you got the glory shining on your face. Okay, so in this setting, what if I asked you to get up, everybody get up and run around the room? You wouldn't be able to do that too well, right? See, cameras can't even follow me right now because it's so dark in the room. Let's see if I can dodge them and weave here. But if I tried to run around the room and got everybody, you know, the thousands of people in the room that are sitting here, asked you guys to run around the room, we couldn't do it very well. There'd be a lot of people that get trampled. There'd be people falling down, be people with hurt shins because they're hitting the sheets on the way around, and we wouldn't be able to do it very well. Let's bring up just the house, okay? Now, if I asked you to run around the room, we could probably do that a little bit better, right? Be able to get around, you can see, you can get direction. See, when there's light, you can have the direction and the vision. You can go where you need to go. Problem is, if I continued to preach like this, you guys would all be kind of leaning forward, squinting, saying, you know, I'm just really not connecting with the message today for some reason. Pastor Dan just must not be on it. I don't know what's going on. See, because you can't really see me. In fact, you look at the backdrop behind me, it's cool backlit, but, you know, really the front of it's kind of drab, you know, kind of monochromatic, kind of boring like that. It's beautiful, but not that great. Let's put some light on it. Ah, now all of a sudden it comes alive. Now all of a sudden it pops. Something's different. Let's turn up the stage lights. There's Pastor Dan. Now we're connecting, right? Now you can see my facial expressions. You can see what's going on. Now all of a sudden, life, not only do you get direction for life, not only can you see where you're going and what you're doing, but now suddenly everything becomes clear. There's understanding. Everything is beautiful. And you're able to see life in a different light. See, the Bible tells us that when we get saved, when you're born again, something happens. Jesus comes into your heart. Jesus is the Lord of life, but he is also the light of life. He is the light that came into the world. Psalm 119 verse 105 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. See, now all of a sudden you can see where you're going. Now all of a sudden you have direction. Now all of a sudden you understand and life becomes beautiful. Look at verse 130 of the same Psalm 119. It says, the entrance of your words gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. See, where you were in darkness before, now all of a sudden you can see and you can understand. I remember at age 15, my brother had gone on a mission trip to Europe, and there in Europe, they shared the gospel in the streets and in the squares, and he came home, and he was just lit up. He was on fire for the Lord. Now, I thought I was a Christian because I was raised in a Christian home. We went to church. I had prayed and got answers to prayers, and you know, had attended church and been raised up, and so I thought that just because, you know, I was a good American and a good little boy and did good things and went to church and that sort of thing, that I had a relationship with the Lord, that I was a Christian, I was saved, going to heaven. And yet when my brother came home and he was on fire, I saw the difference in his life, and he shared with me how they shared the gospel over there in Europe, and he handed me one of the little gospel tracts that they handed out over there. And so I took that gospel tract and I threw it in my pocket, and I walked away from that conversation and I was miserable. I was just like, what is wrong with me? How come he's like that and I'm not? I mean, aren't we both Christians? Aren't we both saved? And I went to bed with my clothes on that night. And in the middle of the night, I woke up and I felt as though the Spirit of God was just hovering over my bed, hovering over me. And I knew immediately what was wrong. I wasn't saved. I hadn't really yet given God all my heart and all my life. So I got up and I reached into my pocket because I was going to get changed. And I found that little gospel tract. And right then and there, I knelt down and I prayed and I invited Jesus into my heart to be my Lord and my Savior. Went to bed that night, fell right to sleep. But that next morning when I woke up, suddenly everything changed. It was like I was walking on air through my house, and there through the window, the sunbeams were coming through the window, and they just seemed to sparkle. Birds were chirping outside, and it was like they were singing the song of heaven. And I'm sitting there thinking, does anybody else hear this? Does anybody else see this? I ran outside, and I looked up at the mountains, and through the smog, even the smog looked better for some reason. I don't know. It's crazy. You know, I was just like, wow. Everything changed. See, what happened was my life was illuminated, and I've never been the same for the past 20 years. God is good. Hallelujah. See, in our life, we need to get an illuminated perspective, like the believers in the book of Hebrews had. See, there's a couple of things that we see that they had an illuminated perspective on, that if we can see how they acted right after they gave their heart and life to Jesus, then we can see how we're to live life. They are our example for today. So today I want to talk about a couple of things, an illuminated perspective on. First thing for today is this, an illuminated perspective on suffering. We see this in the Word, Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 32 and verse number 33, an illuminated perspective on suffering. Look at verse 32, it says, but recall the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great struggle with, what's that word right there? Oh, I'm sorry, is there only six people reading the Word with me today? They endured a great struggle with, what's that word right there? Sufferings. Anybody have that same testimony? Man, I gave my heart to the Lord, and all of a sudden the proverbial poo hit the proverbial fan. You know what I'm talking about now, don't you? It seemed like, man, it would have been better for me not to become a Christian because it was easy then, you know. I didn't have to resist. I didn't have to struggle. I didn't have to strive. I didn't have people hating on me back then. I was the life of the party. Now I'm the death of the party. I show up and everybody, like I threw a wet blanket on everybody. Oh, well, here comes that goody two-shoes. But he says, you endured a great trial with sufferings. And now look at verse 33. Partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. See, in our life, we need to recognize and realize that suffering is going to come our way, but if we can have an illuminated perspective on it, it changes the way we go through the problem and the trial. Speaking of my brother, I remember when he was 18, so I must have been 16 or 17 at the time, he had learned to drive and got a 1974 Dodge Dart. It was a beast of a car. You know, the new ones, they're cool, they're sleek and all that kind of stuff, but they ain't got nothing on 1974. Especially he had a gold 1974 Dodge Dart. It's kind of that goldish brown color, you know what I'm saying? And we had rebuilt the engine, and so it purred. It was just a beautiful car. He installed a sound system in there because, you know, you got to have the tunes. And so we had driven over to a friend of mine's house, and after we were leaving his house, we got in the car and we turned around and we were driving out of the cul-de-sac there. And while we're driving, you know, got to have the tunes, so you got to look at this, okay? You got to watch. He had one hand on the wheel and he was going to change the radio station, so he leaned over to change the station on the radio. Okay, did you get what just happened right now? We're driving straight, and he leaned over to change the radio station. Leaning over, he turned the wheel towards the curb. So we go up on the curb, and there were two mailboxes right there, and ba-bam, he got both of them, all right? Strike. And one of them just leaned straight down like this. The other one kind of whipped around and mail went everywhere. And so he quickly realized what had happened, corrected his course, came off the curb and went back down and parked the car, and we jumped out. And there we are, we're surveying the damage, we're looking, we're kind of like, you know, what do we do here, you know? And so as we're looking at each other, all of a sudden we hear this voice from the house that one of the mailboxes belonged to. Here comes a lady running out of the house, baby on one hip, spoon in the other hand. She's running out, right? What have you done? What's going on? Oh my goodness, look at these mailboxes. What if that was a child? You could have killed somebody. This is crazy. I have a mind to call the police. You're gonna be in trouble. Oh, wait till the neighbor hears about this. My brother and I looked at each other and we thought, oh my goodness, if this is the lady, what's the neighbor gonna do to us, you know? So you just wait right here. I'm going to go get the neighbor. He's going to be so angry. You know, and so we're sitting there, and we're kind of like, whoa, you know, what's going to happen? So she runs up to the neighbor's house, ringing the doorbell, knocking on the door. Suddenly the door opens, and a man comes out, kind of tall, thin man, gray hair, glasses, hands in his pocket, and he comes walking down casually to the mailboxes. Whole time, ladies in his ear, oh my goodness, what's going to happen? What if that was a child? What could have been done here? What do you think we should do to these kids? What are they going to do to these boys? He walks up and surveys the damage, looks at the mailbox, looks at my brother who was kind of cowering, you know, over there. It had been ripped apart. And he looks at my brother and he says, got them both good, didn't you? My brother looks up, yes, sir. The guy says, well, you know, this one we can just stand right back up, not a big deal. And my mailbox, well, I've been working on a new radical design I've been wanting to try out anyway, so... why don't you boys head on home? I'll take care of this. Well, you know what we did. We beat feet out of there because we were like, we're not staying with this lady any longer, you know? And the lady was shocked. She was just kind of like, you know, what? You know? And so we jumped in the car and we said, thank you, bye, we're out, you know? But see, there was two different perspectives. Same event, same thing happened, and yet two totally different approaches. And as Christians, oftentimes when we go through a problem or go through a trial, we have one of two different approaches, right? Oh my goodness, what's going to happen? What's going on? God, I don't understand. Why the pain? Why the suffering? Why the trial? God, why the lack? I thought when I got saved, all of a sudden I was supposed to be this mighty Christian, overcoming everything. Devils flying out of the place. Your money just coming to me. Stuff just happening. Doors opening. I mean, come on, God. Why do I have to go through this trial? Or we can stop, hands in our pocket, smile on our face, and walk up and say, hey, guess what? I don't know what God's doing, but he's doing something good. I don't know how he's going to do it, but God's going to come through. My Bible says that my God works everything to the good of those that love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose. And guess what? I love the Lord and I am called according to his purpose. I don't know what he's doing. I see the trial. I see the pain. I see the suffering, but I'm going to make it through by the grace of God. Come on, are you listening today? Hallelujah. There in Hebrews, turn a couple books back past the book of James to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 4, let's take a look at this in the Word of God together. 1 Peter chapter 4, look at it, verse number 12. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, it says this. It says, beloved, hold on, who's that talking to? talking to us, talking to believers, right? Why? Because we beloved by Jesus. God loves us. We are the beloved now. And he says, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. See, when we encounter trials, it's tough, it's hard. And we say, well, why, God? Why me? Are you picking on me, God? Why did you single me out for suffering? And yet God says, don't think it strange. Why not? Verse 13, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's suffering. See, this is not your sufferings. This is Christ's sufferings going on in and through your life. See, I've been crucified with Christ. No longer I that live, but Christ who lives within me. In the life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and who gave himself for me. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. What does that mean? That means that Jesus is living his life in and through me. And if the road that Jesus walked was a road marked with suffering, then the road that I'm walking with Jesus is also marked with suffering. So it's not strange. It's par for the course. But guess what? We're going to make it through to the other side. St. Augustine said this. He said, God had only one son with no sin. But he has no sons without suffering. See, as Christians, we partake of the life of God, Jesus. He is now our bread that we eat. He is our daily bread. And therefore, as we partake of his life, we also partake of his sufferings. Let's read on. Look what it says, that when his glory is revealed. What is the glory of God? It is his manifested goodness. You say, what did goodness? Manifested goodness. That means the appeared, the revealed, the open and on display for all to see goodness of God. See, God has something good in mind. This sickness is not unto death, but to show forth the glory, the goodness of God. This lack and this need is not cruel and it's not intentional on your part. No, it's to show the mighty hand of God. This trial and this pain that you're going through and the people that have surrounded you and spoke ill of you. No, that is not because that everybody's against you. No, that is to show that God's love will shine through you and God will carry you through the problem and the trial and the pain. That when his glory is revealed, when you see what God was doing, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. You ever gone through a trial and God showed up and you were just happy? See, that's what it's talking about right there. Verse 14, if you are reproached for the name of Christ... What's that mean? People hate on you. Haters gonna hate, right? You are reproached for the name of Christ. Blessed are you. Happy to be envied. Why? Because the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. If you've ever wondered, God, where are you in my pain? God, where are you in my suffering? God, where are you in my trial? You must be a million miles away. I got good news for you today. If you're hurting in this place, if you're lacking in this place, if you're in a trial in this place, the spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. God is near. God is with you. God is right there in the trial and in the pain. God is arms around you, and he is lifting you up into his glory. God is good, and he has a plan in your suffering. On their part, he's blasphemed. But on your part, he's glorified. What does that mean? See, when the world goes through a problem, they're still in darkness. They don't have the illuminated perspective. So when they go through suffering and pain and trials, what do? Oh, curse God. This is God. God got it out for me. He's evil. He's terrible. He's that old man in the clouds. I knew he was waiting to zap me. See, on their part, he's blasphemed. But on your part, he's glorified. What does that mean? You go through the problem. They're watching you. They're waiting for you. Kind of like Job's wife. Curse God and die. And yet, what do you say? Oh, no. No, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. See, on your part, he's glorified. You will display, you will manifest the glory, the goodness of God in and through your life, especially when you come out on the other side smelling like roses. Hallelujah. Verse 15, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, as a busybody in other people's matters. What does that mean? Means that if you suffer for doing wrong, you're getting what you deserve. Because what you sow, you will reap. You gossip about people, talk about people behind their back, they're going to talk about you behind your back. Oh, I'm suffering. I don't know why everybody hates me. It's because you've been hating on everybody else. What did you expect if you're going to go around talking about people's business? Hey, did you hear what happened to so-and-so? Oh, yeah. And did you hear this? Wow. Now, listen, pray for them, brother, because, you know, I don't want to gossip, but I'm just letting you know so that you can pray for them, right? There ain't no praying going on. Don't suffer. You steal something, you go to jail. Oh, God, I don't understand. You stole. What did you expect? Don't be stupid. Look at this, 16. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. What does that mean? That means that when you go through the trial, don't think it's strange, but also don't be ashamed. See, sometimes as Christians, we think we got to go it alone. You know, oh, bless God. I'm going through a problem, going through a trial. You know, brother, how you doing today? Oh, I'm blessed of Almighty God. I am favored of the Lord. And they were like, I'm just asking you how you doing, you know? Good, bad, you know? But we feel like almost if we announce that, you know, oh, I'm going through a trial, that's a negative confession. No, that's a statement of fact. So you can say I'm going through a hard spell, but you know what? God is good. See, that's your confession. You know what? I'm not feeling too well in my body, but by his stripes I was healed. See, now all of a sudden you've let somebody into your world, and now you're not ashamed, but no, now you're speaking the gospel because of the power of God to those who believe. See, if your confession is God is good, God's going to do something, God's working on my behalf, see, you don't have to ignore or keep the facts. No, state the fact, but confront the fact with the word of God. And guess what? If you get someone involved that is faith-filled and faithful, then, well, let's pray together, brother, and then the prayer will really be going on. Having a struggle, having a hard time, I'm not going to say with who, but would you pray for me that I can make it through, that I can walk in love, that I can forgive? I got a lack, I got a need. Can you pray with me that God will provide and God will do something? Yes, let's agree, because if we agree, then Jesus will do it for us. He said if we ask anything in his name, he will go and get it for us. Come on, let's do this. You don't have to be ashamed, but glorify God in this matter. Where you go through the trial, God's at work. God's going to do something. God is coming through. And even if he doesn't, devil, I'm just here to let you know that he is still good anyway. He is still God anyway. I'm still going to praise him anyway. I'm going to go through it anyway. Why? Because we have the illuminated perspective. We can see differently than the world sees. Illuminated perspective, number one, on suffering. Second thing that we see that they had an illuminated perspective on was number two, others. Other people. They had an illuminated perspective on other people. Turn back with me to the book of Hebrews chapter 10 and take a look at verse number 33 and the first part of verse number 34. Hebrews 10 chapter, starting in verse number 33, it says this. It says, partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations. Now look at this. And partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. Everybody say companions. Okay, I want you to remember that. We're going to come back to that in a moment. Verse number 34. For you had compassion on me in my chains. Everybody say compassion. See, this is the outlook that they had for other people. Some people they viewed as companions, and on other people they had compassion. Okay? What does that mean? Well, my wife is over here on the front row, my beautiful wife, Jessica. She's wonderful. We do everything together. We are one. When we got married, we became one flesh, as the Bible says. And now we do life together. We do parenting together. We do pastoring together. We do finances together. We do recreation together. I am blessed that God allows us to play some golf together. Hallelujah. That's a blessing of the Lord when your wife loves golf. Man. And so we do everything together. I don't view her as separate from me. She's over there doing her thing. I'm over here doing... No, no, we're one. I view her as myself. Okay? Now, apply this to the body of Christ, right? The Bible says that we are now all a part of the body of Christ and members of one another. That means when I view you, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, I don't view you as separate from me. No, we are one in the Lord. Now we are all connected to the head, and I don't view you as someone else. I view you as myself. You're my companion. We are doing ministry together. We are doing life together. We are doing church together. We are serving the community together. We are reaching the world together. We are now companions. We're one. And these Hebrew believers that the author is writing to, he says, you became companions of people who were going through trials and suffering. Reproaches. People were speaking mean about them and speaking evil of them and trying to do them harm. And yet, they could have said, well, I don't want anything to do with that. I'll be a Christian, but I'll be a Christian over here. No, they said, hey, we're one. We're a part of this. We've got Jesus now. And guess what? We're standing by your side, and we'll take that same reproach on ourselves. Now, they're companions. So on some people, when you have that illuminated perspective, you don't see the other people in the seats around you as, well, that's just them, or that's just... No, we're one together. But then on others, he said, compassion. He said, you had compassion on me in my chains. In other words, they saw as God sees, and they were moved to a godly action. We see this all throughout the word of the Lord. And in fact, Jesus, God in the flesh, is our example. See, if we're going to see as God sees, we got to take a look at Jesus and see what he saw. Matthew chapter 14, if you will. Matthew chapter number 14, let's take a look at it. Gospel of Matthew right there at the beginning of the New Testament, chapter 14. Let's take a look at the example Jesus leaves us. Matthew chapter 14, verse number 14. Jesus is trying to get away by himself. People hear about where he went, and they come out to him. Matthew chapter 14, verse 14. And when Jesus went out, he saw a great multitude. And he was moved with compassion for them and healed their sick. See, Jesus, when he saw the crowds, he saw their pain. God saw their condition. And he didn't just stand idly by and say, oh, that's too bad, so sad. No, what did he do? He was moved with compassion. He saw them as God sees them, and he saw their pain, and he was moved to a godly action. He healed their sick. Well, going on, Jesus gives a parable in Matthew chapter number 18. Turn there with me, Matthew chapter 18, a couple pages over. Matthew chapter 18, verse number 27 this time. This is the parable of the unforgiving servant. Talks about a servant who's forgiven a great debt by the king. And the king forgives him and sends him out. And he goes out, and then somebody else owes him some money, and he won't forgive that other person. And it's a story really about our lives. It's a heavenly story with an earthly meaning. An illustration that we're to walk in love and forgiveness because we've been forgiven. But everything in the parable has a meaning and it has a purpose. And the characters in the story represent certain people. And the master represents God and the servants represent us. And therefore, he starts to show what the master is like in verse number 27. Let's take a look at what the master, our master, God, our Father, Father God, verse 27 says this, Matthew chapter 18, verse 27. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. See, when God looked on the earth and he saw the sinful condition that we were in, he was moved with compassion. He didn't just say, oh, I'm so sorry that they're going to hell. No, he sent Jesus to the earth. He lived the perfect, spotless, sinless life. He went to the cross and died. And now he has released us when we enter in by faith into the relationship with God, the covenant relationship with God, giving our hearts and lives to the Lord. Now God comes in our life and he released us from the prison and from the shackle of sin. And now he forgives us the debt that we owed, and we no longer are going to receive the penalty of hell. No, that's been poured out on Jesus. He's taken the wrath of God on himself that was stored up for us, and now we are free and we are released from the debt. Hallelujah. One more verse. Turn the next book over to Mark, Mark chapter 6. One more verse. Remember, Jesus is our example. And in Mark chapter 6, we see once again him seeing as God sees and moving as God would move. Mark chapter 6, verse number 34 says this, and Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. See, sometimes when we look around our world and we see people who don't have Jesus, we see them as castaways. We see them as outcast. We see them as so sinful and God can't do anything with them. We get so angry about the sin and the shame in the world. Now, listen, it's okay to get angry at injustice. It's okay to get angered when you see things that are wrong. And it's okay to hate the evil that's going on in the world. That's okay. But when you look at somebody who is a sinner, they are not a Christian, it is not okay to hate them and to criticize and condemn them, and to judge them. No, they're a sinner. Can I say it in San Bernardino terminology for you? Sinner's gonna sin. Just like hater's gonna hate, sinner's gonna sin, right? So when they do what is just by their nature and they go out and sin, why are we there to thump them over the head and say, you're going to hell, you're wrong, I don't like you, stay away, and we're pushing these people away and out. No, we need to see them rather as Jesus sees them, have compassion on them, and they're like sheep without a shepherd. And we need to say, hey, let me show you the more excellent way. Let me teach you about Jesus. Let me share with you what God did in my life. I used to be just like you. I used to have the problems you had. I used to walk the road that you walk. But you don't have to go down that road any longer. Now, Jesus can save you from a life of sin. He can free you from the bondage. You can go to heaven. You can stay out of hell. And I love you enough to tell you the truth. Are you listening today? See, we need to allow companionship and compassion to move us into a loving approach to others. Otherwise, we'll still be in darkness. An illuminated perspective, number one, on suffering. Number two, on others. And number three, an illuminated perspective on eternal life. Last one for today, an illuminated perspective on eternal life. Verse 34, back in the book of Hebrews chapter 10, if you want to turn there with me. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 34, says these words. It says, for you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves in heaven. In other words, even though stuff was going on the earth, things were being taken away from them here on the earth, they had an illuminated perspective. They had an eternal perspective. They didn't have their eyes on earth. They had their eyes on heaven. We are eternal beings. In case you didn't know it in this place today, each and every one of us is going to live forever. Now, we're not going to live here on the earth forever. And we're not going to live in the same bodies we have here on the earth forever. No, we may all die, or Jesus could come back and we may all be changed. But the reality is that we are made eternal beings. And eternity doesn't start when we die or when Jesus comes back. Eternity starts right now. And we are working and living our lives. And the things that we're doing now go on before us into eternity. Two things we're going to take with us when we go into eternity. The word of God, because the word of the Lord stands forever. And people, because people are eternal beings. Everything else is just fluff. It's going to burn. Dirt. Going to be burned up at his coming. So we need to get that eternal perspective in our lives. It doesn't matter what happens to me here on the earth. It doesn't matter what I have or don't have. What matters is eternity. What matters is what I'm doing for my eternity. Ephesians chapter 1, you're there in Hebrews. Turn back to the book of Ephesians. Right after the book of Galatians, you'll find the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, the apostle is praying for the Ephesian church. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 18. Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 18. He prays that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. What does that mean? It means illuminated. That the lights will come on and then you'll get a picture of what this is all about. That you may know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. What is he saying? He's saying on earth, if all you have is an expectancy for this life, you are to be pitied above all men. See, it's not just about stuff here on the earth. He who dies with the most toys, can I say it to you like this, still dies. Not going to take any of it with you. You don't get to take the caddy. You don't get to take the rings or the gold. You can't even take your fillings and your teeth with you on into eternity. Doesn't matter what happens here on the earth. What matters is eternity. And that's why he says that you may know what is the hope of his calling. See, we have hope. Why? Because we have a high calling from God that now we get to go with him and be with him forever in glory. And look at what he says, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? See, you have an inheritance. You're a king's kid. And while you don't have to wait for eternity to tap into that, see, if you have a need, you can call on the kingdom resource here and now. God, I'm in need. I need provision, God. I need your plan. I need your wisdom, God. I need your strength. I need your grace, God. I need healing. God, I call on the kingdom resource into my life. See, you can grab a hold of that. Why? Because it's yours. All of it is yours. Everything God has is yours, and everything you have is God's. That's the covenant partnership that you have. You are one with the Lord now. But look at what he says, the riches, the glory of his inheritance in the saints. See, there's going to come a day where we're going to pass from this life into the next. And no longer will it be the temporary and the corporeal and the physical and the natural. No, now we will see him as he is. We will be face to face with Jesus. And we will fall down before him because we will know him as he knows us. And we will cast our crowns down at his feet and we will worship him forever. Why? Because he is our sun and our shield. He is our exceeding great reward. He is the inheritance we have in heaven. He is our hope. He is the one we are going to see in eternity. There is light at the end of the tunnel, my friends. See, the problem with being in a tunnel is sometimes you get your eyes off the light. Sometimes you look around the tunnel and say, dark in here. It's kind of nasty in here. What is that? You know, and you're walking through and you get your eyes off and you stop instead of moving forward with the perspective of the light. There's a man by the name of Arthur Stace. I want to tell you a little bit about him. He was born in Sydney, Australia in 1884. Mother and father, two brothers and two sisters were all alcoholics. His sister was a brothel operator, living in constant friction with the law. He grew up in poverty, looking after himself and stealing as needed. At age 12, he was made a ward of the state, but received not really a great education. At age 14, he found his first job in a coal mine. And at 15, he was in jail for the very first of many visits. Already, he was well on his way to alcoholism himself. In his 20s, he lived in Surry Hills in Sydney's inner south, running liquor between pubs and brothels, connected with gambling and housebreaking until the start of World War I, where he enlisted. He served in France, returning partly blinded in one eye and suffering the effects of poison gas. From then until the middle of the Great Depression, he slid further down into alcoholism and lived on handouts. On August 6, 1930, he attended a meeting for men at St. Barnabas' Church. Most were there for the food, but there was always a message first. Now, he noticed six tightly dressed people near the front in marked contrast to the bulk of those attending, and he asked the man sitting next to him, who was a well-known criminal, who are they? The man looked at him and said, I reckon they'd be Christians. Now, Arthur Stace looked at him and he said, well, look at them, look at us. I'm having a go at what they got. And he knelt down right there and prayed to invite Jesus into his heart. Now, hardly a remarkable event on the surface of it, but he found that he was subsequently able to give up drinking. And he said, as I got back my self-respect, people were more decent to me. And so he was also able to find steady employment. Some months later in Burton Street Baptist Church in Darlinghurst, of which he was later a member, and also he became the church janitor, he cleaned up the place and was one of the prayer leaders. He heard a noted preacher that came through named Reverend John Ridley speak, or rather shout, on the subject of eternity. And this is what he shouted, I wish I could shout eternity, eternity, through all the streets of Sydney. And he said, eternity, eternity, where will you spend eternity? Stace recalled the day and he said he repeated himself and he kept shouting over and over again, eternity, eternity. And his words were ringing through my brain. As I left the church, suddenly I began crying, and I felt a powerful call from the Lord to write eternity on the ground. I had a piece of chalk in my pocket. I bent down there and wrote it. Now Stace, whose limited education had left him barely able to write his own name legibly, as more than one reporter confirmed, found that he could write eternity, however, quite elegantly, 2 foot wide, in copperplate writing on the pavement. Now, he would get up in the early hours of the morning and leave his home in Pyrmont at 5 or 5:30 a.m. After praying for an hour or so. And he would go out as he believed that God had directed him that particular day and write every 100 meters or so on the pavement as it seemed most visible, eternity. He'd be home by 10 that morning, and such was to be his practice and commitment for the next 33 years of his life. As Arthur himself said, I've been writing it at least 50 times a day ever since. Now, I did a little bit of math. That would mean that he wrote the word eternity over 600,000 times. Arthur Stace grew up in a brothel, came back from war shell-shocked, became a habitual criminal and an alcoholic, found out the truth about eternity in Christ, and spread the word to others, eventually affecting the lives of millions of people who saw the word in 50-foot letters at the end of the New Year's Millennium fireworks show when they honored his memory. Look up on the overheads there. That's how he would write eternity right there. Millions of people around the world saw that fireworks show because it was right at the end of 1999 into the year 2000. Now today's legacy lives on in Sydney, where there are several memorials, including plaques and etchings of his handwritten one-word message, eternity. I wonder if we lived with an eternal perspective, how different our lives would be. Would we worry about money? Probably not. Why? Because in the grand scheme of things, God's got this. Money is passing away, and in eternity, God's got it all covered. I won't have any need of it. Would we fight with our friends and loved ones? Would we be unforgiving and hold on to a grudge? Or would we just let it be water under the bridge? Listen, I love you with the love of the Lord, and I forgive you as God in Christ forgave me. Why? Because in eternity, this doesn't matter. It's not a big deal. Would we make a big deal out of little things? No. Why? Because when you draw it out in the scope of eternity, that's just a little bump in the road. That's a little teeny tiny hurdle. That's just a pothole of life. And I'm not going to get stuck in that ditch. Why? Because I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Or would we, with our perspective on eternity, go through sufferings and trials in the light of God's counsel, knowing that God is good and He's going to do something with our lives? And when we start to view others as ourselves and start to view others with compassion and be moved to tell others about Jesus and to help others with their eternity, just like Arthur Stace did, who now continues to speak his one-word message to us, eternity. Romans chapter 8 and verse 18 says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Church, we need to get our eyes off of the temporary and get our eyes onto the eternal. Eternity! Eternity! Hallelujah! Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Woo. Eternity! Eternity! I wonder, do you know where you're going to spend your eternity? Would ask you a question about your life. I want you to answer the question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Where will you spend your eternity? Will you go to heaven or will you go to hell? Just answer that question in your heart silently. No one will know the answer but you and God. I'm going to ask no one get up, no one leave during this time, nobody moving around, nobody passing out notes. Listen up, because your eternal life is at stake. Sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. I don't think it's a real place. You know, I think it's just a fairy tale made up by parents to scare their kids into being good." Problem with that thinking is, did you know that all throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, in fact, Jesus himself spoke about hell. That means that hell is a very real place. And you're not going to avoid it by saying that it doesn't exist. That's like burying your head in the sand and hoping that the wind won't touch you. It's foolish. And I'm here to tell you, as a loving pastor, you need to look out. Just like if my children were running in the street and I saw a car coming at them, I wouldn't say, "Oh, honey, I love you so much. Can you please come over here on this side of the white line and make sure that none of the cars hit you?" No. What would I do? I'd yell at them, "Hey, get out of the street. You're going to be a little pancake over there if you don't get over here." And in the same way, I'm here today, getting in your face and saying, "Hey, hell is real. And I don't want you to go there. You don't want to go there. And God doesn't want you there. Never intended for you and me. Made for the devil and his angels who rebelled." But we can choose with our lives here on the earth where we go, whether heaven or hell. Sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven." Really? Could you show that to me in the Bible? Because it's not there. It's like saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You will never make it to the moon. In the same way, you can't just do whatever you want. Can't do what I say. Can't do what some well-meaning church committee says. Got to get there God's way. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me." It's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Jesus was talking to a religious leader of his day by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a good guy raised up in his church called the synagogue. He got involved, became one of the leaders, did a lot of good deeds throughout his life. He could quote the scripture, he could sing the scripture, he could debate the scripture. Now, after all that, we would have thought that would have got him into heaven. All of his goodness, all of his deeds, all of his church attendance, all of the volunteerism and the different things that he did, we would have thought all that would have got him into heaven. And yet Jesus doesn't commend him or pat him on the back and say, hey, Nick, man, you're so cool. Just keep doing what you're doing and I'll see you in heaven. No, he doesn't say that at all. Rather, he says, Nicodemus, you want to enter the kingdom of heaven? You must be born again. It's that simple. You can't be good enough to work your way into heaven. You can't attend enough church to get into heaven. You can't be born in America or born into a Christian family and that qualifies you for heaven. It doesn't work like that. And I'm here to tell you today, if that's how you think you're getting into heaven, not going to make it. And you're going to end up in hell. But today you can change destinies because Jesus said you must be born again. Now I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it through the coals, made it out to be something that it's not. Weirdo, crazy. Listen, let's not let society and movies and television and Hollywood and the internet tell us what being born again is. Let's find out from the Bible what it means. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. That simple. All or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. He says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Those are pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and then, an occasional church attendance. Having head knowledge about who Jesus is. Look up here at me. Having head knowledge about who Jesus is. And yet not really wholehearted for the things of God. Oh yeah, you're okay with God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. Can't just know about God. How do I know that? Because the demons know about God. They knew who Jesus was. They believed he was the Son of God. The devil himself knows who Jesus is. The devil himself is recorded as quoting scriptures in the Bible. How crazy is that? And yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So this is not about having mental assent or head knowledge about who Jesus is. This is about an all your heart and all your life commitment. Lukewarm Christians are not real Christians at all. Otherwise, why would they be rejected and ejected from the body of Christ? So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity to give God all of your heart. Give God all of your life. Denying your presence in hell and going to be with Jesus in heaven forever and ever and ever for eternity. Here's what I'm going to do. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. Pop my hands together. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You say, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Oh, yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that embarrassment today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. No one's that dumb. And yet the devil thinks that you are. That's why he's trying to talk you out of it right now. Listen, tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God. Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better. And listen, no one's criticizing you, condemning you, judging you. We love you in this place. We want you to do this. I shared with you my testimony today. Listen, now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place and you identified that? That's the condition of my heart. And hey, get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, in the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down and get ready to get your hand up. All over the world on our live stream, if you need to do this, God is watching you, then you can click the button on our homepage that says how to know God or respond to God if you see that button there by your browser, and someone will lead you in a prayer right where you're at. God's watching you. Come on, let's get ready to get our hands up all together on the count of three. If you need to do this, this is your time. This is your moment of salvation. This is where you change your eternal destiny. Here we go. One, two, Three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, thank you. There's one. There's two. God bless you. Who else? There's three. Got you over there. Where you at? There's four up on top. Got you. Five, six. Thank you. Seven. Got you over here. Thank you. Eight in the foyer. Got you over there. Nine up top. Thank you. 10 over here. 11. Got you over there. God bless you. 12. Thank you. Thank you on that side. On this side. Who else? 13. Got you down here. Got you. 14. Thank you. Who else? 15 and 16. God bless you. Up on top over there. Thank you. 17. Got you over there. Got you over there. Anybody else real quick? About a 17 wise people. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? I want to change destinies today. If that's you, just raise up your hand high and let me see it. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? About 17 wise people. Anybody else? Come on, just raise it up high for me. 17. 17, there's 18. Got you over there on this side. Over there. Thank you. 18. Got you. Anybody else real quick? Come on, number 19. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Come on, let's go for it today. Let's go for it today. Where are you at? Number 18. Number 19, I mean. Number 19, got you over there. Thank you. Oh, don't you just feel number 20. Number 20, where are you at? They're pointing over here. I don't see you yet. Come on, give me a little wave if that's... Thank you, number 20. God bless you. Come on, let's give the Lord a great deep praise. The 20 wise people. Woo! God is good. All right, all 20 of you. You're in the family rooms? Hey, this is for you too. If you're in the foyer and you raise your hand, this is for you too. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. There's five more of you that you need to get your stuff, get in the aisle, and meet us up front right now. And you come. Let's all stand and welcome them. No one leaves during this time. You come right now. Just make it right to the front. Come on down. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come too. Come on. From the families, bring your children. Come on down. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
The reason that I live, the reason that I breathe.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
I believe in you.
Hallelujah. Come on. Come on.
Jesus, I belong.
You can come right now. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
Even if you didn't raise your hand, just come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Nudge your neighbor. Come on, friend. I'll go with you. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I belong.
They're still coming. You can come too. Come on, they're still coming. We'll wait for you. Come on down right now. Hallelujah. They're still coming.
Jesus, I believe.
They're still coming. Come on down. Come on down.
Jesus, I belong to you.
I don't know how to count, apparently, because there's a whole lot more than even 25 up here. Hallelujah. So cool. So cool. Everybody up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing, all right? Came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life. Everything changes on the inside from this point on, all right? It's a good thing. I want to introduce you to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. See this handsome gentleman right over here waving at you? This is Reverend Antonio, okay? Good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on, all right? He's going to do three things. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance. You're not wondering or concerned. What are they going to do with me? He's just going to lead you in a simple prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature you can take home, read about what just happened in your life, right? Well, now that you're a Christian, what do you do next, all right? He'll give that to you absolutely free. And then he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church and a program we have called a spiritual personal trainer. We want to get you in relationship one-on-one. Why? Because now that you're a Christian, we see you as ourselves, and you're a part of us, and we want to help raise you up and train you in the way of the Lord so you don't go back serving the devil, but you go on serving the Lord to eternity, okay? Spiritual personal trainer is that friend who will help you in church to get strong in the ways of the Lord. Now, listen, listen, listen. Give us 1 year, just 1 year of your life, sitting consistently under the teaching here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center, consistently. Listen, we have 11 church services a week, okay? Get into... One, two, why not be crazy and radical? Three, four church services a week if you can. Why not? But consistently do that. If you can get one, get one. If you can get two or three, get as much as you can consistently, week after week, sitting under the teaching here. And at the end of that year and for the rest of your life, you will say, oh my goodness, I did not realize it could be this good. Am I telling the truth, everybody? Take their word for it. It all starts with an SPT. It's easy, it's free. He'll describe how it works and they'll let you come right back in. So if you guys will make a left turn, follow Reverend Antonio right this way. Love you, Tony. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.